St. Thomas Aquinas was born in the south of Italy, in the Naples area, and entered as a student, as a young boy, the monastery of Monte Cassino to study, that is, and was formed therein, but was drawn to the new movement of the Dominican order because of the richness of the charism that it proposed. He combined in his person many vocations. He refused once, if not several times, to become bishop and archbishop. He knew that his vocation was that of the pen. Here we are. The pen. The pen still writes. Every word written is read and opened and speaks again. And therefore the pen is still moving through time every time a book is opened and read. Words have power. He combined in his person the best of knowledge of the time, being a disciple of St. Albert the Great. He had studied at Paris, at Cologne, and was in contact with this universal doctor, and like him he saw the good that was there already around. And so St. Thomas took Aristotle, therefore pre-Christian philosophy and thought, and Christianized it. He was not afraid of any knowledge, for logic is a participation in the order of the Blessed Trinity. All knowledge is a participation in divine knowledge. And so a Christian has no fear of any knowledge. The word science, scientia, comes from scio, I know. And so we might be inclined to think nowadays that there's some kind of contradiction. It's not at all the case. We placidly learn from prayer, from theology, from philosophy, from logic, and from science. For it is all discovery. And not invention, or an uncovering, which is the meaning of discovery of what is already there. At the end of his life, he, having written this great Summa, had a mystical experience, after which he came to and said, "All I have written is but so much straw." Indeed, stories tell us that he would look to the Blessed Sacrament for much of his inspiration, place his head close to the door, perhaps even knock the door, and if he was really puzzled, not getting the answer, open the door and put his head inside. We know also that he, one time, was rather puzzled whether he'd actually got the whole truth with regard to the Blessed Sacrament, on which he was writing at great length, and he was given to understand, Bene scripsisti de me, Thoma. You have written well of me, Thomas. You have written well of the sacrament of my body. So, it is all unchanging truth. And as we look at the habit that he bore, we see precisely the element of the monastic life, the black Benedictine, hence they're called the black friars, for they have that element of the cloister still there. And the white, we have here perhaps an influence of the Primos Detentions. He himself, Dominic, was, as a young man, a canon of Osmer. And they took on some of the monastic and Primos Detention ways of doing things. They kept the Divine Office sung in choir, they kept the structure, but they did not have the stability, stabilitas loci. They were able to move around, and all their cloisters were their own. Obedience would send them. And so they were available for the work of the Church, initially against the Albigensians, then later against any error or discord in the body of the Church. But we see precisely how it was efficacious. It was because they had this interiority which we see in the picture of St. Dominic, the contemplation of the regard, looking inwards and listening, and the book which nourishes the mind, and also which they are able to produce. An ideal which still attracts young men to this day, fellowship, beauty of singing, the quietness of learning. The process of learning, the student life, is by orientation somewhat contemplative. It is input rather than output. Later comes the output, but when one is a student, one is taking in passively and actively, but not yet having to share it. And so it is a privileged time when society frees us from manual work and enables us, as the privileged people of this world, to take in knowledge in the name of humanity. But we notice precisely in the Dominican charism and in the figure of St. Thomas the element of infused knowledge. We have, even in our day, in, for instance, high-powered charismatic sessions, instances of people receiving, in French they call it le don de la science, the gift of knowledge, they know things. But we have it also in even ordinary day life, that we are sometimes suddenly made aware by intuition of things, or we are prompted to do things or to ask things so as to get knowledge from a person who will answer. It's all very close to an acquiring of knowledge directly from God, because if we're in a state of grace, He can somehow suggest things to our mind, and we can, if we want to, sharpen that faculty. We can become more and more receptive, passive, calm, able to be worked upon, therefore to perceive the little things. Often we are a barrage to further knowledge by too much talking, too much fidgeting, too much nowadays looking at powerful YouTubes. Anything which is aggressively powerful on the imagination takes away from that calm passivity, passiveness of receptivity. We need to be calm beings to ingest knowledge well. And there is sometimes a very thin barrier between natural sources of knowledge and directly divine ones. Let us just be calm, prayerful, and let the Lord suggest things to us. Give us, too, the gift of some kind of infused knowledge. If we are close to Him, He can share His secrets with us and make us feel as He feels, know what He knows. If, on the other hand, we think we know it all, then He leaves us to get on with our huge amount of knowledge. So much straw.
not as me give a chaste as me ad in plebis me let it sea cum voto Te celos, tibi gloria Deo Patri et Filio, cum Sancto Spiritu, in saecula saeculorum.
Student among the Jesuits sent back to study at Milltown there in Dublin. This is a reference to a message with regard to the future. Along the corridors of learning here we walk again and gain a little more for thought and mutterance, for very near to those who pick the sleeping brains of yore are hovering weighty truths, and we are one with souls that have long gone on and on, to knowings deepened much, for such have done their thinking, for each thought for one day shone. O thinker of the world, to know and rest within thine ancient vision, and to hear these syllables traced, steered at thy behest, this is to know that this vast isle is clear, and that the hand that holds me holds it all, and bids me but walk on where angels call.